Hi everyone, how are you doing? This is Global Trends course for New Abyssinian College students. Today we will start chapter 4, which is about globalization and regionalism. We thought we will see what is globalization, what is regionalism, and what is the relationship between these two concepts. So in the world we are living right now, the world is becoming very interconnected. And this is mainly called globalization. And it is often understood as a phenomena or a process characterized by increasing interconnectedness or interdependency. That is bringing the world into one global village. That means you can reach any person in any part of the world by using the modern information technology, or you can get anything, either it is clothes or it is an electronics product or any other thing from any part of the world within a few days. And that this trend or this development is called globalization, the world becoming a very small place because of information technology. On the other hand, regionalism is conveyed as a way of dealing with political, economical, social, military, and other security issues affecting status in common by using regional arrangements. So globalization, it is an issue related with the whole world, whereas regionalism is a concept related with a specific region. For example, you might hear about Horn of Africa or North Africa or European Union. We saw European Union, we saw Asia, and we saw North African Continental Free Trade Agreement. These are regional arrangements, and when countries use those arrangements to solve this problem, it is called regionalism. Whereas if the world uses the international arrangement or the global arrangement, we call that globalization or globalism. So the mutual connection between regionalism and globalization is an area of unsettling debate involving convergence, divergence, and overlap. So in this chapter, we will bring the whole theoretical and practical debate around regionalism, regional integration, and globalization. We will start from globalization. We will see regionalism, regional integration, and the relationship between all these concepts. When we start from globalization, globalization can be defined as a multidimensional process. It is a multidimensional process. It is an incremental process, and it is characterized by the following four characteristics. The first one is the stretching of social and political activities across state frontiers. Stretching of social and political activities across frontiers, that means across different countries. For example, if you see some movie or a television program from some other country and starts wearing like the way you see on the television, that means the social practice of the world is becoming globalized. In addition, in the political sphere, everything what happens in this country affects the issue of the other country. And this is the first characteristics of globalization. The other is the intensification or the growing magnitudes of interconnectedness in almost in every aspect of social existence. There is interconnectedness. We import products from different countries. We hear music from another country. And there is a lot of movements of peoples among countries. This is the second aspect or characteristics of globalization. The third aspect is the accelerations of pace of global inter interaction and process as the evolutions of worldwide systems of transportation and communication. There is social media and there is other communication tools, and the development and the existence of this communication tools accelerate our interaction between peoples in different countries. The other characteristic is the growing extensity, intensity, and velocity of global interaction. It is the same with what he said in the album. There is cultures adapted by different peoples from another people. There is other things. That means the velocity or the movements of this interaction is becoming very fast. The interaction is becoming very fast every year. And this is the four characteristics of globalization. From this, we can understand that the globalized world, that this indicated that in the global world, territorial boundaries no longer demarcate the boundaries of national economic or political space. So the economic and the political space of any country in the 21st century is determined by what happened in the world rather than solely by the domestic situations. That means the world economic and political situation affected the country's political and economic situations. And globalization is a continuous issue in the international relations, and there is a lot of debate on the direction where globalization is going. It is in its nature and it is in its effect. Some people think globalization has negative effect, others say globalization is positive effect. So in this regard, there are three perspectives, or there are three types of thinkings on globalization. There is the hyper-globalist, there are the skeptics, and the transformationalists. All these three have different understanding or different view about the effect and the natures of globalization. So when we start from the hyper-globalist, they define globalization as a new epoch in the human history in which nation states became obsolete to regulate their economy and boundary. So they believe the roles of nation states is becoming insignificant, and the globalized system is the main determining force on the economic and other factors of a specific country. And these views of globalization privilege the economy over the political, the market over the state, and prefigure the declines of state. They believe the roles of state is decreasing over time, and the international system is the main managing force in the economic and political affairs of the country. And these hyper-globalists, people who believe the world is becoming hyper-globalist, advocates of this view argue that, that means advocates of hyper-globalists argue that economic globalization is bringing about denationalization, deterritorialization of economies through the establishment of transnational networks of production, trade, and finance. So they believe there is internationalization of production, there is internationalization of trade and finance. And they believe this is denationalizing or deterritorializing the economic establishments of states. So that means the state is not the determinant factor in its economy. The hyper-globalists also claim that economic globalization is generating a new patterns of losers and winners in the international system. So they acknowledge or they believe that this is creating a loser, which is the southern parts of the world, and there is a winner, which is the northern parts of the world. And globalization is imparting new liberal ideas and implant cultures of modernizing, replacing the traditional culture and creating new global order. They believe this globalization is creating a liberal idea throughout the world and a global order. We hit the views of the hyper-globalists. So the main idea behind the hyper-globalist is globalization is creating an international or global order which minimizes the roles of national states. The second is the skeptics. This is the other types of peoples, or they are skeptical about globalization and they reject the views of the hyper-globalist, and this one claims it is dependent on the regulatory powers of the state to ensure the continuation of economic liberalism. States are central actors and agents of globalization, playing central role in the shaping and regulating of the economic activity. So in the other hand, the first one believes globalization is the main force shaping the world. But in here, the skeptics rather believes the state are the main power to decide whether to globalize or not to globalize, or to liberalize or not to liberalize. So without the roles of the state, they believe there is no globalization, and it is still the state are the main playing actor in the globalization process. And they argue that there is no free flow of goods, resources, technology, and finance at the global level. So the first one believes this global order is affecting the whole part of the world. But in here, they believe this globalization is happening more in European Union and in the other Northern American countries rather than the other parts of the world. And they believe that their West is only more integrated. The flows of technology is very slow, and the relationship only benefits developed countries. So in here, it is the same with the first one. The first one also believes there is a division between North and South. But in here, the idea is more developed. That means the flows of technology or the globalization is benefiting only developing countries. That means developing countries are losing from globalization. For the skeptics, globalization brings nothing new. Rather, it is just the crystallizations of the already existing realities, which is marked by North-South gap. So they believe globalization doesn't result any new thing for most parts of the world. Rather, it keeps the divisions of North-South divisions. That means the income inequality and the inequality in development. This is how the skeptics see globalization. The other is a transformationalist. This is an idea between the hyper-globalist and the skeptics. So for transformationalists, globalization is a critical driving force behind rapid social, political, and economic changes, which are reshaping societies and international politics. So they believe globalization is a critical driving force. And they also say there is no longer a clear distinction between the international and domestic affairs. At the core of the view is that globalization is reconstructing or re-engineering the power function and authorities of the state. So the first, the hyper-globalists believe globalization is dismantling the roles of the state. That means there is no more role for the state. On the other hand, the skeptics believe the state are still the main driving force. But in here, the transformationalists bring a middle view, which means globalization has an effect, but its effect is re-engineering the power function and the authorities of the state. And they say even if states still have ultimate legal power to control events inside its boundary, but it can't command sole control over transboundary issues. actors and resource movements. So they believe the state has control on issues which is found inside the territories, but it does not have any control on issues which is transboundary, which is among countries. So under globalization, national economic space no more considers with state boundaries. So globalization, under globalization, the economic issue is more than decided by more than issues which happens in places other than the state's boundary. And they reject both the hyper-globalist view and the skeptics view, which is the hyper-globalist view of end of sovereign state, and the skeptics claims that nothing much has changed. So it is a view in between these two theories. And the role of state is redefined by the emergence of non-state actors who are becoming a main player. So transformationalists believe there are players like international organizations which are also becoming a main actor in the international politics. So the three, the transformationalists, the skeptics, and the hyper-globalists are the perspectives on how globalization is affecting the world. So what is the impacts of globalization on the continents of Africa? What is effect on the Africa? And we also see what is effect in our country. So when we start from the general effects of globalization in the contemporary form, globalization is driven by various forces. There are forces which are pushing globalization in the world stage. And there are flows of financial resources, the flows of goods and services, and to a very limited extent, labor and technology, especially transport, communication, and information technology. And also the spreads of culture as well as ideologies. So all these words we call financial resource, goods and services, technology, labor, information technology, these are issues or resources which are moving around countries. On the other aspect, there are unique to the presence of the globalizations are the Americanizations of the world. There are flows of goods and services, and in addition, there are flows of the idea which is called Americanization throughout the world. What Americanization result? What resulted Americanization is the huge gap between the United States and its nearest rival in each and every sphere. That means the United States is very strong compared with other states in terms of military, economy, technology, and cultural developments. So this makes all the international institutions under the US influence. Most of the institutions or the economic and military activities of the world is under the influence of the US, and that created Americanizations of the global economic and political environment. Globalization transformed the world as imperial system under American hegemony. That means the present globalized system is under the controls of the US. So within these systems, that means the systems of Americanization or globalization, decisions and outcomes are largely the results of American unilateral based on Washington consensus. So it is the idea, Washington consensus is the idea that the world should have a free market based and a liberal democracy. Washington's consensus is an American system which believes there should be free trade in the world and liberal democracy. And this became the main idea in the present globalization of the social and economic environment. And the result of this Americanization leads globalization the result of this American-led globalization is different for different parts of the world. So we said the American system is the main idea, but its effect is different among countries. It is effectively different for Europe, different for Africa, different for Asia, and it is effectively different for the United States. So let's see its effect on Africa. In the case of Africa, its position in the international system has been considerably weakened by the fact that it has been losing the race of economic development in general and human development in particular. So the idea, the generalization is that because of globalization, Africa is losing its economic development and it is largely impacted negatively by the globalization. The Cold War has had significant consequences for Africa, witnessed the emergence of authoritarian regimes in most of parts of African countries in the forms of one party or military regime by the support of two parties. So before this American-based Washington consensus started, that means in the Cold War period, it has a large effect for the emergency of military regimes. On the other hand, after the end of the World War, end of support resulted many failed states and decline in the strategic importance of the continent. This leads to a decline in the negotiation powers of the continent. By the times of the Cold War, there was Russia and there was United States of America. They support different parts of different ideologies. So these different ideologies resulted in one party military regime in the 1950s and 1960s. But in the 1980s, the Cold War ended by the failures or the destructions of the Russia or divisions of Russia, USSR into different countries. So that resulted in end of support for these authoritarian regimes and resulted many failed states in different parts of the world. For example, we can see Ethiopia. In the times of the Cold War, Ethiopia was under the leadership of Derg. When the Cold War ended, Russia ended support for the Derg, and that resulted the end of Derg. And after that, the EPRDF, or Ethiopian People Democratic Party, Democratic at the Front, started power. When we see the specific impact in general, the general impact is that globalization has a negative, more negative impact than positive impact in Africa. When we see specifically, we can see the political effect and the economic effects of globalization in Africa. In the political sphere, it created the erosion of sovereignty in economic and financial matters. In political sphere, it created an erosion of sovereignty in economic and financial matters as a result of the impositions of development policies by IMF, World Bank, and World Trade Organization. These are institutions we saw in our last episodes of this course, and these institutions imposed policies on Africa. And globalization has negative impact on the development and effective government of African countries because of the influence by external actors. The involvement of a lot of influential external actors affects effective governance of African countries. Globalization also weakens national consensus and cohesion, leading to social divisions and instability, which in turn facilitates the emergence of authoritarian rules. Because of globalization, countries unable to control their social division, and that created authoritarian government. On, if we take one positive impact, one positive impact of globalization, that means in the political sphere in Africa, is that it has made available information on how other countries are governed. That means the African countries or peoples in Africa able to see how the governments of the other parts of the world is, and freedom and rights for their peoples, which opened African countries to extent of external security. That means the other parts of the world able to see how Africa is governed. In another hand, in another way, the Africans also able to see how the other parts of the world is governed and how the other parts of the world, the people living in the other parts of the world, are getting freedom. This is the one positive political effects of globalization. Globalization has have also negative impact on the continent than, that means in general, globalization has more negative effects than positive effects. It has often pressured African leaders to adopt policies and measures that are diametrically opposite to the feeling and sentiments of vast majorities of their peoples, which resulted in many authoritarian regimes. It resulted failures of government because it accepted principles of democratic governance and such as good governance, transparency, and accountability, which is a narrow term. In globalization, every country, or in the globalization, the American lead or Washington consensus lead globalization, every country needs to accept democratic government. And they define democracy in good governance, transparency, accountability, and which resulted many failed governments in Africa. Globalization also created poverty and inequality. The development policies that focused on stabilization and privatization rather than growth and development pushed by external factors resulted poverty in Africa. Rather than development, they promote privatization and stabilization and also liberalization. This resulted poverty and inequality in Africa. It also divided the continent and its cohesion. It divided countries in Africa to adhere into different powers. This happens by imposing economic specialization based on the needs and interests of external factors. By this time, it is very difficult to trade among African countries and to have strong economic relationship, because the African countries specialized on the agriculture products like coffee, tea, cacao, and something, which is very difficult to trade among African countries. There is also politicalizations of every aspect of the peoples in the African countries. This happened by economic specialization imposed on African countries, which makes rapid and sustainable growth and development impossible. So when development and growth becomes difficult, it results conflict of gains, and it becomes more acute and politicalized, and at the end, it creates instability. By instance of African countries supporting their economy to foreign goods and entrepreneurs, globalization limits the ability of African countries to facilitate the emergence of an indigenous entrepreneur class. So it becomes very difficult for countries in Africa to create an entrepreneur class of society, because everything is a copy paste from the other parts of the world. And because of liberalization, it is very difficult to produce a product in Africa and compete with the other parts of the world. All these are the negative impacts of globalization. When we see the specific economic impact globalization has on the whole, reinforced the economic marginalizations of African countries and their dependency on primary goods on which demand and price are externally determined. Globalization in terms of economy, it marginalized Africa, because globalization made African countries to produce only primary goods, which is very few even in diversity or in quantity. And the price of these products is determined by the external actors or the developing countries. This results in marginalizations of the continent, and this resulted poverty and economic inequality, as well as the abilities of the vast majority of Africans to participate meaningfully in the social and political lives of their countries. That means this poverty and inequality minimizes the ability of the society to participate in social and political lives of the country. This triggered also a substantial brain drain from Africa. That means when countries became poor and unable to create employment and decent job, especially educated people fly to the other parts of the world, and that created a brain drain in Africa. Finally, globalization distorts patterns of production in Africa, notably by utilizing capital as against labor-intensive methods, which leads to large unemployment. Globalization distorts production patterns. That means because of globalization, it is very difficult to produce labor-intensive products and compete in the global sphere. And that created also unemployment. That is the case of Africa. When we minimize that one and see what is the results of globalization or what is the consequence of globalization in Ethiopia, it is most probably the same with the other parts of Africa. Ethiopia is one of the countries that was marginalized, marginally integrated to capitalist system during the post-Cold War era. That means after the falls of the Derg, the country went to choose from socialism to capitalism. That means it is the Washington consensus types of economic structure, and which was messed by that time. So in the post-1991 period, Ethiopia found itself facing the challenges of democratization and the reconstructions of post-conflict society. Now the Derg is over. By the time the country faces two different things, either it should democratize itself or it should reconstruct the economy. So with defense strategy, Ethiopia found itself in collision with Western free market economy and liberal democracy, which has a major effect on the loan and development assistance. If you don't want to liberalize your economy and accept free market, the institutions we call IMF, World Bank, and World Trade Organization, they will no more support you, and that will affect the economies of the country. But with strategic thinking, Ethiopia achieved economic transformation and gained from the positive opportunities of globalization in the form of technological and knowledge transfer, free movement of ideas, people, and finance. That means compared with other African countries, Ethiopia benefits more positively from the globalization, even if the general impacts of globalization is more negative than positive. We at least able to get some benefits from globalization. On the negative side, the expansions of information communication opened the historical closed door of Ethiopia to new religion, secular values, and that affects the religiously and social solidarity of the people. So because of globalization, the country opened for information technology, new ideas in the world, democracy and liberalism. And that was different from the long-lasting ideology of Ethiopia. And that resulted a lot of problem. Even by this time, it creates radical nationalism and ethnicity. Country-based nationalism, people started ethnic-based nationalism and they started ethnicity. And this resulted also human trafficking and migration, and the movements of which is a brain drain from the country to the other parts of the world. When we generalize this, Ethiopia has benefited less from globalization than its negative influence. In general, the globalization resulted more negative impact than positive on the Ethiopian economy. So in the world sphere, so as a general, globalization has positive and negative consequences, where the world became more globalized and more interconnected. It is our pros and cons. That means positive and negative effects. When we start from the positive or the pros, it helps the expansions of democratic culture, human rights, and the protections of historical minorities. So because of globalization, it enables expansions of democracy and human rights. Globalization promotes innovation in science, medicine, technology, and information communication technologies. Information communication, which enables improvement of quality of life and lifted millions of people out of poverty. So because of globalization, it promotes innovation in science. For example, countries like China, they utilized globalization effectively and they lifted billions of people from poverty. That means they used globalization in a more positive sense. The technology and social revolution contributed for advancements of human security and safety. There is also, with time, the security and the safety of the people is improving, and that happened because of globalization. Moreover, free movements of goods, service, people, idea, expertise, knowledge, and technology across national borders strengthen international interdependence. So there is interdependence among countries, and it was strengthened by globalization. In this turn, globalization to the proofs of the new sense of global citizenship. This in turn, globalization contributed to the basis of any sense of global citizenship. That means a people or individuals call themselves as citizens of the world rather than a specific country, which is called global citizenship. Developments of shared responsibilities of the goals. Global society for protecting valuable groups from human rights violation is also another positive impact of globalization. Developments of shared sense of responsibility for peoples who are unable to protect themselves. And this is the positive sides of globalization. On the negative side, or the cons of globalization, it resulted in the prevalence of growing gap between rich and poor individuals. It created a lot of poor and very rich individuals in a country level, and it also created rich and poor countries, very few rich countries and many poor countries. Western imperialisms of ideas and beliefs are eroding and eroding the sovereignty of non-Western countries. So because of the globalization, Western-based ideas and ideologies, that means the Americanizations of the world is eroding the sovereignty of other countries. With technological advancement, climate, environment, and technological risks have been multiplied. So by this time, there are a lot of technological risks. Like Facebook is becoming a main tool for the transmissions of false news and hate speech. On the other hand, there is environmental impact like global warming. There is other issues or problems that have been multiplied by globalization. And it also contributed for global terrorism, religious fundamentalism, proliferations of small arms and light weapons, arms and human trafficking. There is a lot of terrorism, religious fundamentalism, which is because of globalization. It also creates identity conflict and radicalization. Identity conflict and radicalization. Countries of the global south have faced multidimensional economic, political, social, cultural, security, and military challenges induced by globalization. Global South means countries which are poor, like Ethiopia. They are faced with a lot of economic and political problems because of globalization. So that means these positive or pros of globalization are happening mostly in the northern parts of the world, and the cons or the negative sides of globalization is happening in the southern parts of the world or the poor countries. So now we see globalization and the views of different people about globalization, its impact on Africa and other parts of the world, and we see the positive and negative sides of globalization. Now we will see what is regionalism and regional integration. Regions can be defined as a limited number of states linked together by geographic relation and by degree of mutual interdependence. For example, when you see a region, you can take Horn of Africa. This Horn of Africa includes countries like Ethiopia, Sudan, Eritrea, Djibouti, Somalia, and Kenya. So this Horn of Africa is called region. Why it became a region is because they are linked together by geographical interconnectedness. And regionalism refers to intensifying political or economic behaviors or process of cooperation among states. So when these states, these countries who are interlinked geographically, starts integrating more, or when they have more activities economically, or when there is more cooperation, that is called regionalism. On the other hand, regionalization can be confined to growth of societal integration within a given region. So we call it regionalism or regionalization. That means when countries became more integrated in a given geography. And this regionalism or regionalization is done by voluntary association and by pulling together resources in order to create common functional and institutional arrangements. So regionalism, opposite to globalization, regionalism is happening or increasing by a voluntary base of countries. They pull together resources, they create institutions, and they strengthen regionalization. And the main goals of their arrangements are to strengthen themselves in economic, cultural, scientific, diplomatic, political, and military interactions. So when we see the history of regionalism or regionalization, there is old regionalism and there is also new regionalism. Old regionalism, it covers time before the 1980s or 1970s, the time including, mainly this regionalism started with World War, and the old regionalism is the time period that starts from the World War up to the end of the Cold War, and we call it old regionalism. And for many scholars, regionalism as a voluntary and a compressive process is predominantly a post-World War II phenomena, and it started in Europe, and they believe it started in Europe and expanded to the other parts of the world. When you see regional integration in Europe and beyond in the old time, old regionalism has its root in the devastating experience of interwar nationalism and World War II. They started to see states as a problem, tried to develop regionalism in Europe as a tool for peace and security. There is World War, and they believe this World War is because of states are becoming the main actor in the international process. So regionalism for the European, when they started regionalism, the main goals of regionalism is to create peace and security. So in the old regionalism in Europe, the main goal is to create peace and security. So the idea resulted European coal and steel community and also European atomic energy community. At the end, these two institutions integrated and created European Commission through the Treaty of Rome. So after the end of the World War, the countries believed that by controlling the movements of coal and steel, which is the main source or the main instrument for the war, if we control these resources, they believe they can create lasting peace in Europe. So to control the movements of coal and steel, they created coal and steel community with the membership of Germany, France, Belgium, Czechoslovakia, and other states in Europe. There is also European Atomic Energy Commission. And this Atomic Energy Commission was an institution that manages atomic production in Europe. Then they integrated into European Commission. At the end, they became European Union, and it is a successful experiment in regionalization and come to dominate the discourse in the mode of regionalization. So they started with two institutions, they become European Community, and after that, they become European Union. And this process is one of the successful regionalization in the world, and it is being copied by other countries. In Africa, when we see regionalism in Africa and in other parts of the world, regionalization was closely linked to colonialism and anti-colonialism, and also the quest to facilitate the economic development in the newly independent states. As we said, in Europe, the main goals of regionalism was to create peace and security. But in Africa and as a developing world, regionalism is a way to solve colonialism or to end colonialism and to create economic development. So different from European keyword here, where development state promoted industrialization and national building. So the goals of regionalism in Africa was to create industrialization, nation building, and development. And it was mainly, the main goal source was to create import substituting industries by using the structuralist school of thought about. So this structuralist, as we saw in chapter one, is that they believe that the north or the developed countries are negatively affecting the developing countries by exporting a low-priced product and everything. So they believe by developing port substituting industries, they can develop their country. Also, the same as in Africa, in Latin America, the idea was to create liberal inter-regional trade in combination with regional protectionism, which creates large economies of scale and wide market, which could serve as a stimulus to industrialization, economic growth, and investment. In Latin America, too, their main goal was to create economies of scale by creating a large market in the region and protecting any product coming from other parts of the world. So integrating the Latin American countries, making trade among themselves free and charging tax for products which comes from the other parts of the world, like European Union or the North America. So this the structuralist school also shifted its focus away from economic integration as a means of peace and political unification to one of regional economic cooperation, integration as a means of economic development and state formation. So because of this structuralist school or structuralist view, integration was seen as a tool to economic development rather than as a tool to peace and security. So these types of regionalism resulted in creations of Latin American Free Trade Agreement, LAFTA, in Montevideo in 1960, and it included all the Southern American countries. So because by using this school of thought, the structuralist school of thought, they plan to use regionalism as a tool to economic development by liberalizing trade in the region and creating a large market. So this old regionalism in Latin America made little economic impact and was never implemented in large scale. And sadly, this school of thought, or this ways of using regionalism as a tool to economic development, was failed in Latin America. And regionalism in Latin America, the failure is mainly because of the structure or of the countries, or and the conflict and military dictatorship in Southern America. It wasn't implemented effectively and it failed to create economic development. So even if it failed in creating development, it was copied by Africa. And it even also created a divisions of Casablanca and Monrovia types of regionalism in Africa. In Africa, it was totally copied by the Monrovia group. And when integration started in Africa, or when regionalism started in Africa, there was two groups. The first one is called Casablanca, the other is called Monrovia. The Casablanca group, if you hear about Kwame Nkrumah, they believe on creating one country, making Africa one country. Rather, the Monrovia group believe that is not possible to create a single country. The continent, they believe the continent is big, and rather they wanted to create an institution the same with Latin America, and that resulted in the organizations of African Union. And the major ideological influence on regional cooperation, however, is embodied in the founding principles of organizations of African Union, and later in African Union, Logos Plan of Action, the Abuja Treaty, and other many treaties that was signed in Africa. It was copied from the Latin American system, and the main goal was to create a free trade types of arrangement in Africa and integrate the continent with phases. And which is the major purpose of regionalism, was to resist colonial and post-colonial influence, protectionism, and realizations of import substitution. So in Africa, integration was taken, or regionalization is taken as a tool to end colonialism, to protect the economies of the country, and to develop import substituting industries. That is old regionalism. Old regionalism means between the World Wars up till the end of the Cold War. So new regionalism started with the end of the Cold War, and the prospect for the walls of Berlin, the falls of the Berlin Wall, together with the 1985 White Paper on the international market and the single European Act, resulted the new dynamic process of European integration, which is called new regionalism. In the old regionalism, the main goals of the European integration, as I said, is to create peace and security. But in the new regionalism, it resulted increase in the numbers of regional trade agreements. Now the focus changed into trade as an externally oriented and less protectionist types of regionalism, and anti-hegemonic types of regionalism concentrated around trade schemes or security cooperation, as with a more varied institutional designs. So now in the new regionalism, the main focus is trade, and resulted the proliferation of a lot of regional trade agreements. And they are the results of the structural change in global system because of the end of the Cold War, which ended the bipolar arrangements of the world and the beginnings of the American-based Americanizations of the world, or the global economy. And it is also the results of the intensifications of globalization. So in these times of new regionalism, the world resulted many trade agreements. For example, in Africa, there are a lot of free trade agreements. If you hear about IGAD, which is Intergovernmental Authority for Development, there is a SADC, South African Development Cooperation. There is ECOWAS, Economic Cooperations of West African States. There are Eastern African Community, Central African Free Trade India Area, and a lot of other arrangements. And these are the results of the new regionalism. This regionalism has theories, or which theories means which enables to understand what is the purpose and the goals of regionalism. The first theory is the functionalism theory of regional integration. So this functionalist viewed regionalism as a functional response by status to the problems that derived from regional interdependence and means of solving common problem. So the functionalists believe regionalism is a tool to solve regional problems. And it becomes a reality because if we integrate at a regional level, we can create interdependence and we can solve our common problem. So according to functionalists, the tasks of policymakers is to encourage states to peacefully work together. So the functionalists believe the task of policymaker is to promote states to work peacefully. And the like-minded states would spread the web of international activities and through which the interests and lives of all states would be gradually integrated from one activity to the other. So policymakers start to make the country work well. When they start to work well, they will start trading with other country. When they start trading, that means they increase their interdependency. This interdependency created an institution to manage the interdependency and created regional integration. And a regional organization was then built up to cope with one common problem and spill over into another problem and areas of cooperation, which will deepen integration and institutional development among member countries. So that means there is Ethiopia and there is Somalia, Djibouti, and Eritrea. When they start trade, a problem will pop out to about their trade relationship. To solve their trade relationship, that means they start integrating or making common policies for trade. When they make common policies for trade, they will continue to other areas like political areas, social areas, cultural, and they believe, the functionalists believe, through time these countries became more integrated because of the function that integration or regionalism creates. So this spillover effect leads finally to the formations of supranational institutions and to the diminishing roles of the national state. So with time, when they integrate, that created organizations like, for example, there is IGAD, which is an institution between the Horn of African countries. With time, when countries became more integrated, the roles of these institutions increased. These institutions became supernatural, and when they became very strong, the roles of the state will diminish with time. And this can be applicable in national and regional level. This is the functionalist view, and there is also new functionalism. That means an idea which develops after the functionalist school of thought. And Political integration for the new functionalist, political integration is the process whereby political actors are persuaded to shift their loyalty and political activity towards a new center, whose institution possesses or demand jurisdiction over the pre-existing national status. And the end result of the process of political integration is a new political community supplemented over the pre-existing one. So different from the functionalist believes different function. When we integrated with different functions, it created international or supranational organization. For the new functionalist, rather, regionalism exists when political actors able to give some of their responsibilities for the international actor. And this process of political integration in a new political community supplemented over the existing one. That means it decreases the roles of the state. The one of the new functionalist school of thought advocate who is Lindberg puts the following preconditions for the successful integration process. That means the new functionalists, for the new functionalists for integration to happen, the following four preconditions should be fulfilled. The first is central institution and central policy should be established and developed. That means there should be central policy and an institution. Second, their task and capacity should go well given the mandates of normal and institutional, international institutions. That means this institution should be given a lot of power. That means additional power than the existing institution. And third, their task should be inherently expansive. That means the idea or the roles of this institution is to expand over time, and the tasks that given should be in direction with this expansive idea or this expansive behavior. And the fourth is there should be some link between the interest of member states and the process of integration. So that means the member states that should support the idea of integration for the integration to happen. So if an integration idea fulfills these four preconditions, I believe integration can happen among countries. There is also intergovernmentalists. Intergovernmentalist or liberal governmentalist is a theory and approach that focused on the state for integration to succeed. So according to Moravisic, who is the advocates of intergovernmentalism, integration can be considered as part of a rational choice of state actors. So intergovernmentalists believe in state inherently are more inclined toward this integration. That means the roles of the state should be helping the country to integrate with other parts of the world or with its neighboring countries. And they disaggregate the process of integration into three stages. The first stage is national preference formation, then interest bargaining, and an institutional choice. The problem with this approach is that international relations has not given much weight to the domestic level. So they give a lot of emphasis for the roles of state for the integration to happen, and they believe integration is rational choice for the state. Now, let us see selected cases of regional integration. We will see three cases, which is the European Union, the associations of Eastern Asian states, and the African state as African Union as three cases of regional integration. There are a lot of regional organizations in the world. Even in Africa, there are a lot of regional organizations. There are regional organizations in North America, South America, in Asia, and in Caribbean, in a lot of parts of the world. But here we'll see these three examples. Regional integration across the world follows divergent trajectories. That means they followed different ways. yet it was mainly influenced by the development in Europe, even if the countries follow different paths to integration. The European ways of integration is the most influential one. The European Union begins as European Steel and Coal Council, and they developed to European Economic Community and then transformed into a common market, currency, institutions, and policy harmonizations that at last which became European Union as one of the consolidated regional organizations. As I said earlier, European Union started with after 1945 as European Steel and Coal Community. Its main goal was to control the flows of steel and coal. Then they developed into European Economic Community. That means a free trade arrangement among countries. And at the end, in 1994, the European Union became a single economic unit with a single currency. Now, if you heard of euro, which is a currency of European Union, which includes 27 countries, Germany, Italy, France, Belgium, and all the most of the European countries are members of European Union, and now it is one of the most consolidated region in the world. The other is the Organizations of African Union, which comes into existence in 1963. As you will know, the head office of the African Union is found in Addis Ababa, and it was organized in 1963. And it started as Organizations of African Union, OAU, and then it changed its name into African Union, AU, in 2001. And why it changed it? It is mainly influenced by the European approaches of integration. As I said, the European approaches of integration affects most parts of the world. The other is the ASEAN, which is Associations of Southeast Asian States, was founded in 1967 and established a preferential area in 1997 and Asian Free Trade Area in 1992. That means after 1992, they became Asian Free Trade Area. It enables a free movement of goods and services among countries. In the first two decades after the Second World War, that means 1945 to 1965, the region was shaped by nationalism, decolonization, great power intervention, and failed attempt to regional cooperation. That means there wasn't a lot of cooperation before 1967 in Asia. But after 1967, they managed to create this association. And the main motives was not economical. When they first started the association, it was mainly for political security motives and for regional solidarity. The main goal was political security and regional solidarity. But after the economic crisis in 1997, the region advanced into economic goal and created Asian Preferential Free Trade Area. And now, the Asia is a free trade area and they trade goods and services freely. And these are the three main examples of regional integration in the world. Now we saw globalization and we saw regionalism. We said globalization is the process in which the world became a small village with information technology and fast interconnectedness among countries. We also saw regionalism, which is a process in which countries who are connected geographically and other factors created cooperation among themselves. When we see the relationship between globalization and regionalism, we find mainly three types of relationship, three possible relationship between regionalism and globalization. And we can call it dimensions, and this relationship is mainly seen as economic dimension. And the first dimension is regionalism as a component of globalization, that means convergent trends. From when we see from this dimension, regionalism is emerging today as a potential force in the process of globalization, as one component or chapters of globalization. When we see from this dimension, the regionalization in Africa, the regionalization in Europe, and the regionalization in Asia are one component or one chapters of globalization. That means countries in Africa will be integrated by themselves, countries in Europe will be integrated themselves, and then they come together as a unit and integrate at a global level. So when we see from this direction, from this dimension, globalization is a component of, regionalism is a component of globalization. And by helping national economies to become more competitive in the world market, economic integration, regional integration will lead to multilateral cooperation on a global scale. So they believe when countries integrated into a regional level, they will become more competitive in their economy. And when they become more competitive, it will make the globalization process simple. So those the process of regional integration can be integrated, interpreted as part of global economic order and one component of globalization in 21st century. So they believe this regionalism is one component, and it is regionalism which is pushing globalization, and therefore globalization may be expressed through regionalism. So when we see regionalism as a component, a convergence view, global regionalism is one component of globalization. The other view is regionalism as a challenge or a response to globalization, or divergent view. Convergent, and in here divergence, that means regionalization, the main challenges of regionalization is to decrease or to halt the fast movements of the world into a globalization. And unlike the first trend, regionalization might stem from a reaction and a challenge to the amorphous and democratic and inexorable economic rules of globalization. As we saw in the first part, globalization is more helpful for developed countries and affected developing countries negatively. And when we see from the divergent view, regionalism is a response for that globalization. That means they are trying to minimize the effects of globalization by integrating regionally and by making free trade among themselves and putting tariff and other restriction for trade and other relationship of as from for trade and economic activities coming from other parts of the world. So by creating trade bloc and integration framework based on mercantilist premise, regionalism opposes the neoliberal hegemony of states' interests of world economy in favor of regional loyalty. And the formations of regional regions might be also motivated by the denials of a single universal culture and ideology and the promotions of alternative or pluralism among the regions. The third dimension is regionalism and globalization are a parallel process, or they overlap to each other. When we refer to the world economy, it encompasses the trends of both regionalism and globalization. Regionalism, which is the divisions of international economy to mega regions of North America, Europe, Eastern Asia, Africa, and the Middle East, all these divisions is regionalism. On the other hand, globalization is the movement of the world into a single trading bloc. So they believe they are going into the same direction, but they are doing the same task. Both of them are doing the same task and they are overlapping. So the third possibility is that regionalism and globalization might be acting as a parallel or overlap process. So we can see the relationships of globalization and regionalism from these three dimensions. We can also see the relationship between regionalism, globalization, and state. So when we put these three actors, the state, the region, and the global, we can see the following seven types of relationship among themselves, bringing the factors of nationalism and possible roles of the nation state into the question creates the following possible links. Number one, nation states oppose globalization. Number two, nationalism and formations of new states are encouraged by the force of globalization, which means convergent trend. Nation states oppose the force of regionalism, which is a divergent trend. Nationalism and nation state can be strengthened through regionalism. This is the relationship between state and regionalism. Regionalization coexists with nationalism and globalization. This is overlapping trend. The sixth one is nation state mediators between the trends of regionalism and globalization, which is also a overlapping trend. And the last one is nation states oppose globalization through regionalization. So when we put these three actors, the state, the region, and the global actors, we can find the seven types of relationship. So when we summarize the chapter about globalization and regionalism, the world is becoming a small place because of globalization, and it has positive and negative influence for countries. And developed countries are more beneficial than developing, which is poor countries in the globalization process. Globalization affects Africa and Ethiopia in negative way than positive way. So countries organize themselves in regional blocks to defense against globalization. So we said globalization is affecting developing countries negatively. And since Africa and Ethiopia is one of the developing countries and continents, they are affected by globalization more negatively than positively. And as a response to this negative effect, countries and continents like Africa and Ethiopia creates regional blocks. On the other hand, regionalization and globalization has different relationship, and the states are also the main actors in regionalization and globalization. So what countries should do is to understand the trends of the globalization and regionalism and tries to get as most benefits as possible from this process. So we'll meet later in chapter 5. This is the end of chapter 4. Thank you very much. See you later.